There is nothing to compare it with. It's the most exhilarating place in the world. It's like being able to fly, just like growing wings. If it's in your blood, you can't get it out. You just want more.
You put the earplugs in, the helmet goes on, everything goes quiet. You know it's ahead of you and everything else around you's forgotten. It's time to get on with the job.
My mind goes completely blank. My mind just goes into madness.
Any put manners in as that man, you know, in my day, lad, and all that. But I think, you know, what a boy. Just, you know, if he was naughty, he used to give us the slipper. We know he was getting it because he used to warm it up on a radiator before he'd give us it. If he was naughty again, which was mostly me, I was naughty all the time, we used to have to pick stones up so the lawnmower wouldn't run over him. He used to have his own putting green out the back of school, and we used to, that was our main job, was keeping the putting green right and mowing grass, so yeah. And then, yeah, I thought natural progression, I wanted to go and race him. I've still got my first engine I ever had. Suffer punch lawnmower engine. I mean, it's down there. Yeah, I just used to play with it, that's all I wanted to do. Oh, I wasn't bothered about. You know, I had a few mates, but I wasn't bothered about, you know, girls. I'm still not bothered about girls, really. I mean, I'm not gay or out, but I'm just, you know, rather play with lorries and tractors and engines. Still, I haven't really grown up. No, I haven't grown up. Right and down, Bob. Bit mad. Just,
Oh, you're mad.
What would you say? Title short of a roof. One short of a six-pack. A few slates adrift. We'd use that one a lot. Lights are on, but no one's on. I can imagine from the outside looking in, anyone that's racing the TT looks like the lights are on, but no one's on. Oh, my God. TT. I obviously had a proper roller coaster because I haven't won one. I'll try it. I don't give it. Barashim wasn't a big fan, was he? He thought it was too dangerous, did he? There you go, a lager shandy drinking Southern Fufflers. There you go, that says it all, doesn't it? Yeah. I'll say we're away, innit? I was only watching that the other night. The Dam Busters. Yeah, it's mega that, Wallace Barnes. You know, the idea that got into that was, not Napoleon. Who was your boy that used the battleships? Give him the name. Not Napoleon. Different things make different people happy, don't they? Some lads love going to the pub. I'm not being in the pub. Some lads love shagging. I don't like shagging. I don't mind it. I'm not into it. I'd rather just go and ride your motorbikes and my pushbikes, you know. It's whatever you're into, innit? It was all the same. Everybody made a TT, wasn't it? But different things make different people tick. And that makes me tick. And that's why I'm going to keep going. That's why I'm going to keep going until I've won one. Or won five. That's when I'm like winning five in a week. That's not been done before. So I've got to do that. And then that's it. I'll go find the next job to it. I've got another big goal. This is a massive, is it? Well, it's massive, it's not massive, is it? It's not massive. People use that word, don't they? And you people, I tell you what people, word people use all the time. Unbelievable. Oh, you can't use that word, can you? Unbelievable. When a man, like I've said this before, when a man eats his own head, I will then hold my hands up and say, right, that was unbelievable, because I can't believe a man can eat his own head. But, like we say never.
Unbelievable! Absolutely unbelievable!
Evel Knievel was the big sort of stunt man at the time, and I had Stars and Stripes suit, and I had Stars and Stripes helmet, and I thought it was Evel Knievel, you know. And my dad used to build me a ramp, and they used to jump 14 toy buses, where Evel Knievel tried to jump the 14 real buses, and I wrote to Jim Will Fix It for me to do a jump with him, and never even replied back, the miserable old goat, but it's always been in me. I don't know any different. I'm not really interested in anything else, you know, football, cricket or anything. It's just been bikes all the way through my life.
He's still a little boy at heart. He's crackers, really. When I met him, he just finished motocross and he was wanting to get into racing bikes. And he always said, you know, I'm going to do an Isle of Man TT race one day. And he said, I just want to win a TT and I've got it under my belt and that's it. I'll never do it again. And he won his first 250 race and we were like, oh, that's it, he's going to finish now. And I thought, thank God for that. But, you know, it just makes that bug grow even bigger, I think.
Even then, when I was 10 years old, I used to watch it and it used to just blow me away. I used to think, you know, that's going to be a bit of me one day, you know, I'm going to win one of these. And if I'd have been sat there then and somebody had said, you know, I'd have 15 wins, you know, you'd probably laughed at them and fell off the wall, you know. But here I am with 15 wins. But I still get that, you know, jitters now and, you know, like, TT's coming, you know, you're building up, get apprehensive, nervous, and months before the TT, you know, and I won't think about it, it makes me skip a heartbeat, really, then.
I have to have the house immaculate, my garage has got to be immaculate, everything's got to be at its place, I'm all alone, make sure that's all right, clean the cars, so just in case anything does happen, then everything's ready, you know, so, but I definitely think about it. And, you know, it's got to cross your mind. It has to cross your mind because it's there all the time. It's a reality that you know, you might not come back.
John McGillis, 17:43, 127th annual record from a standing start.
For two incredible weeks each summer, generations of men and women have made the pilgrimage to the Isle of Man to pit themselves against the track which has achieved international status. and become synonymous with speed and glory. At a time when the maximum permitted speed on English roads was just 20 miles per hour and racing strictly prohibited, a band of enthusiasts intent on testing their bikes and themselves to the limits of speed and endurance gathered on the Isle of Man. And in 1907, the Tourist Trophy was born.
You see, look at the suspension. You see? And then put it the other way. Watch that. Keep watching. It'll do something. See? Look at that. Hey?
Me and Guy's got the typical father-son relationship.
Yeah.
Guy knows best and I knows best.
Yeah.
I'll get a brew on.
You see, steady cam, that's what it is. What's that shocker's in it, I suppose?
What?
See, when you was holding that thing, you can jar, but that takes all the jar out of the camera, doesn't it? The deer. I bet it's deer, that, innit? Go on, how much is that arm there then? 1,400?
Yeah.
Fuck off. 14 grand. 14 grand. Fucking hell. Fucking hell. See that? 14 grand.
My first TT was 74, riding a Gus Coon Norton Commando production bike. And I thought, I'm going to be a TT superstar here. So I set off from the...
How old was you?
I was... how old was I? 1974. 47. What's that then?
I don't know. 75, 27, 5.
Anyway, come into Glen Ellen, up Craig Willie's Hill, cranked it in, down, no further to go, bang, straight over the bank. The bike finished up in 3 bits, and I brought me back, and I was back at the TT again the following year.
Our worst crash ever? Probably northwest. 2008, come off at Blackie, I lost the front on the apex of the corner. Not fast, maybe 120 mile an hour. Hit the curb with my ass at 120 mile an hour. And walked away, no bother. The bike was nothing, we could hardly salvage anything. Everything was written off on it, everything. And I got away from that, but it scared me. It didn't scare me for life, it just... proper. I just thought, another one of those moments, I just thought, oof. But I suppose that, you know, get it wrong, you're an inch out here, that's it. Yeah, we like that. I'm not, like I said, on masochist, really. I'm not purposely going out there trying to kill myself. No, no, definitely not. The opposite, really. I want to succeed, you know. But that's the buzz that you get out of trying to do that. You do end up in that position where it looks like it's going to be game over at any moment. But those positions, money cannot buy the buzz that you get there. Thing that you get that you think, that's it, game over. You don't go into panic or out, you just, this is it, game over. Been in about 4 of them since I've been racing, and I've been racing 10 years now. And all of those moments, I think 3 of those moments were at the TT.
I come to the gym a couple of times a week and, get out on my mountain bike a couple of times a week. I enjoy my training and keeps me focused on the job. I don't like anything to sort of let my riding slip. If, you know, a bit of training is what it takes, and that's what I do. I've always been a bike fanatic, but my parents have always been against it. And by the time I got to 15, I think I'd wore my parents down that much. They were a bit concerned about me getting a road bike, so they got me a trials bike. And the minute I was 17, I took my test and got a road bike, so it backfired a bit on my parents. But, you know, I met a group of lads that blagged a caravan for free. It was an absolute wreck. Dragged it all over the country, it was falling apart, and we got to race meetings, had a few beers, had a barbecue, raced all day. You know, it was just great to experience that side of it. Natural ability pulls you through to a certain level, but if I'm in a race and it comes down to a tight battle and, you know, I lose the race basically through fitness or something, you know, I'd be devastated with myself, so I get very obsessed about what I'm doing. There's only one outcome for me, to win the race.
Every one of the 37 and three-quarter miles of public roads that makes up the course has created a champion or hero. Over 200 corners must be negotiated up to six times to complete the world's toughest road race in the fastest time. There are five races over a week, culminating with a senior TT. With speeds of up to 200 miles per hour and the opportunity for disaster around every corner, its dangers are set in stone. To date, 231 riders have lost their lives on the TT course. To win just one TT is an outstanding achievement. The legendary Joey Dunlop has an unmatched 26 wins. John McGuinness holds the outright lap record. And Phil McCallum is the only rider to have won four out of the five races run each year. No one has ever won five out of five.
So the laundry didn't come back.
You know, I get told off for not saying the right thing, or doing this, or doing that, and not wearing the right clothes and what have you, and you know. And it just sort of gets on top of you sometimes. Well, not gets on top of you, but you just text the phone out of it all. Whereas Wilson, for me, you know, he's doing it for the same reasons I'm doing it, you know, doing it to enjoy it and doing it to win.
And I see it as David and Goliath. And I think that's what motivates me in many ways. That's perfect, yeah. The guy come back to a small team and can win.
Could you call it a deal, Wilson? There aren't really a lot of paper signing going on. Just a firm handshake, I think, Wilson.
I suppose I should say, to have a gentleman's agreement, we need two gentlemen.
Well, I wouldn't have said I was a gentleman, in a way.
Thank you. Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah, but we won't go as far as gentlemen. No.
You knew when I was wanking, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, you used to regularly wake up and see a guy pulling my mouth. Yeah. I had to go back to bed for a few minutes while I finished him sent off.
Yeah, because I used to sleep above the cow and I
slept above you, didn't I?
Yeah. You could tell.
I didn't really know that until I broke my ankle right back. I remember that. Yeah. Your toes go, do you know?
When you wank. Yeah.
So and then you see guys' toes twitching.
And you knew I was on it.
In the morning, his toes would be going, you think, I'll give you 5 more minutes.
Yeah, grab it up.
In the build-up to the TT, every other race meeting is a chance to perfect the bikes, impress new sponsors, and develop the speeds needed to compete on the Isle of Man.
You're going to rotate?
We're not here for any lap times to fuck off. We're not bothered whether we're last or first. We're not bothered. We're just here so survive.
Just whoever's built level.
You need to be a good mechanic to, you know, to work with me. And I'm a bit awkward to get on with, I suppose, because I'm very particular how I want stuff doing. Most motorbike riders just, you know, get on it and turn the throttle, but I like to know what makes that bike tick. You know, I like the whole idea behind the whole internal combustion engine and the way stuff's made. And you need to have a bit of mechanical sympathy, don't you? You can't go charging in there like a bull in a china shop. It's all going to end in tears, isn't it? You end up breaking gearboxes and blowing engines up and all that sort of caper.
Still no quick shifting. No, don't know anyone that's got one.
No.
Mechanical failure is what all riders dread. Sometimes they're overwrapped and
sometimes something breaks. You know, if a part breaks, then it's just bad for everybody. And the TT particularly, because where you only get one hit, and you've got to wait 12 months to have another go.
I don't have heroes until Chris Mayo. Yeah, he's the boy. Mad in a way. You know, lovely bloke. You know, his dogs. Nearly got his dog to talk. Nearly. Likes his grandfather clocks. Makes his own wine. He's got a grapevine growing out his garden through a window that he's chiselled out in his conservatory that grows into his conservatory around there. You know, gets his own grapes, makes his own wine. That's a boy, that, isn't it? Not many folk do that.
I got an entry to the TT in 73 and I crashed in both races. So I saw more of Noble's Hospital than the track, really. What I do basically is take a road engine and turn it into a race engine. My biggest boast, I think, was in the 100th year of the TT. Every single winning engine or lap record machine came out of this workshop. You know, Guy, I think, has got the best bikes he ever could. I shall obviously do my best, and Guy obviously will put the finishing touches to it. He's happy. He'll be there. I have every confidence that if things work in our favour, we're going to come away with a result. One thing I'm concerned about is we mustn't start thinking it's our turn, because it never is your turn. But I think the ingredients are right, if they're mixed properly.
Northern Ireland's Northwest 200 race meeting also takes place on public roads and is the very last chance to get the bikes ready for the TT.
Heads down for the lights above the track. This race will be underway. Michael Dunlop's been mugged, hasn't he?
And boy, with Michael Dunlop then just looking what was going on in front of him. He's coming over the hill. That's 65 miles an hour.
Man's corner, that.
Michael Dunlop and his brother William are the next generation of the road racing dynasty that began with their uncle Joey and father Robert Dunlop.
They were the biggest road racers, I think, that the world has ever had, you know. So, you know, the inspiration I got from them was so much. And growing up with two people, you never seen them as heroes or superstars, you just seen them as two normal people.
Joey blew out the competition when in 2000, aged 49, he won a third hat trick of TT races. He was killed 3 weeks later in a little-known race in Estonia. Over 50,000 mourners attended his funeral. His brother Robert was almost killed in 1998 when his rear wheel collapsed in an accident at the TT. But raced for 10 more years until his death in 2008 during the final practice lap at the Northwest 200.
He knew the circuit, he knew it well, and a mechanical failure happened, and it happened to, you know, the best of riders, which was, you know, it was a sad loss to the sport, a sad loss to us, you know, but for some reason I just thought that Saturday then I wanted to ride the 250.
2 days after witnessing his father's death, Michael went on to win the race and reduce the onlookers to tears.
You're only a young man, you know what I mean? All you have for life is a bit of crack, you know what I mean? And you don't think you're going to have to bring on a lot of stuff. So like, I turned in from a boy to a man in a very short space of time. You know, I mean, I hope they're up there now and they're being looked after.
Oh, God, it's Cummins! Connor Cummins, the Isleman rider, he's fast, really very fast. Oh, he's down! Cummins is down!
I took the lead.
Ryan just was coming out of the corner, back end sort of stepped out on me and high side of me over the top of the bike. I was, you know, really, really lucky to come away unhurt there. I just had to pick myself up. I got, you know, dusted myself down, straight out on the bike in the next race, and fall off a horse, get straight back on it.
Guy has taken a tumble too.
I'm all right. I mean, yeah, it's not bad, is it? I mean, it's been down. I've done that. My finger. Didn't have my eye on the ball. You know, so much going on, and lost my fault. Hit the curb on the inside, took the front, ended up in the grass, but it was all okay. We had to put a new radio, engine cover, water hose. Didn't wreck it.
Guy Martin, the engine is gone.
In the second race, Guy overreps the bike and blows up his engine.
He's completely out of the race.
This was not a good meeting here as far as results are concerned. We had a couple of things that didn't go according to plan. But it has been a learning curve. You may think we're a bit old to be learning, but we're still learning. The upside, Guy would go to the TT with that bike and two brand new engines. Brand new.
Please, not bad. We need to work on speed a little bit. It's not bad. The stability's gone down. All the tyres are good. We need to work on you and you.
I'm going, and my ferry's booked. I'm going in the camper. Because otherwise you sat at home. You know, you sat at home just twisting your thumbs, you know, waiting for a phone call. So you might as well be there among it all.
Attracted riders and race fans to watch their heroes race the mountain course. Modest prize money means that this close-knit band of brothers ride purely for the love of the sport and the glory of winning.
If you're born on the Isle of Man, you're sort of brought up with motorbikes and races. You've got the island going from black and white, quiet rural country roads. All of a sudden, they've got teams of bikers going down them. It's just lovely to see the island come alive.
Stories skipped away to the height of their door.
It's a festival, it's a coming together of everyone who appreciates motorcycling. The stories that are told as you sit at the hedge or the marshals in groups around the island are all lived and relived every year, and we never get tired of swapping them.
Let's just say there's a large segment of the motorcycling population in America that knows well about the TT, as I do, and probably have put it on their what we call a bucket list, things to do before you kick the bucket, to go to the TT, and that's why I'm here. I had the opportunity to come. It's something I've always wanted to do. My father and I have talked about coming here together for years and never did. He's passed away, so it's on me to come and enjoy the experience and share it with him however I can later on, perhaps.
Well, I've worn this leather for 27 years now, and at least 27 years more I will bring the leathers to the TT.
My name is Karen Anderson, and I've come all the way from Australia to watch Cameron Donald race TT.
We sat above here in a room on the balcony,
and we watched the guys coming around that corner, and there was a lamppost there, and the lamppost was padded, and they would come round dipping, and then they'd do that in and out to get round the lamppost, and that's me, hot in my mouth, hot in my mouth, hot in my mouth. Brilliant.
Yeah, I know what can happen. We're there on the back, you won't get too quick, else you get beat up.
It's a very hairy place, very fast. To watch the bravest men in the world. And if it doesn't excite you, you're not alive. That's a fact.
Within hours of arriving, Guy is unhappy with the bike's suspension, and in particular the swinging arm because of its importance for a fast wheel change.
Wilson, can we put the other swinging arm in and get Simon to change the wheel? It's shit. And it's going all wrong. The bike was given to me in the first place, Wilson. It wouldn't be going through this problem. And I did say this in the first place.
Guy has upset the authorities too because of his plans to work on the bikes away from the paddock.
I was expecting it to be tension because that's why I've stayed out of the way. I've got my airbed that goes in the back of my van. I've just been staying in my van. When it comes to how I want bikes preparing, if they aren't right, that's it. I'll just pack in and go home. I won't stick my neck out if things aren't exactly how I want them, and I'm so meticulous with things. But we're going to meet in the middle. We're going to have a meet in the middle, aren't we? I can't have it all my way because, I mean, Wilson's bought the bikes and put a lot of money into the bikes. You know, but I'm the one risking my neck out there, and that's why my head needs to be right. And Wilson always has said from the off that my head needs to be right. And then to get my head right, it needs to be my way, which is doing bikes with no interruptions. But yeah, well, I think we're going to have to meet in the middle, me and Wilson. The bikes have to be back here at a certain time, and then I'll have to do certain bits of nodding and smiling and agreeing with people.
There's a contract, and the team gets X number of pounds, so they expect Guy to be professional, and Guy sometimes makes statements that they don't like. People like him, maybe it's caused a bit of a rebel about him, and so on. So we just have to make do with what we have. If I dictated to Guy, it wouldn't work. It's just a mechanic who is a brilliant rider, a brilliant motorcyclist. The bikes are ready to race, but he has to have his touch to the bikes. He knows I've given him everything he has asked for. So, you know, it has to work this time. And the bike will be checked again for anything, and then you're in the lap of the gods.
If you get this corner right and make a proper job of it, you can make 10 seconds of it because, you know, you don't brake or let go of the throttle for the next 3 miles. But it's a man's corner, get it wrong, you're get it wrong and it's going to hurt. But you don't think about things like that, do you? If you want a fast lap out, you've got to throw your balls to the wall, as it says.
The weather.
After a bright start today, it will turn cloudy later this morning. Then, although staying mostly dry, there could be a little patchy light drizzle.
I think Guy Martin's real rivals this year will be manifold. Cameron Donald's always been a threat.
He's a bit highly strung.
bikes fast, real fast.
Alan Cummings is going to be a big threat.
Alan Cummings, local maintenance.
He's fit as young.
Ryan Farquhar has gone ahead of George Dunlop at National Winds in Ireland.
It's phenomenal.
The Dunlops are coming strong. Michael's really aggressive, got that will to win.
No, definitely I'm not going to get in a ring with him anyway.
Keith Moore again, he's not going to lead, you know, he's just chomping at that bit to go fast and win.
You never know what Chris you're going to get.
If Chris wakes up in the morning and says he wants to beat us all, he'll probably beat us all.
You never bet against John McGuinness. He's the man at the minute.
He's the man with the results on the board. He's the man when you go quicker, he usually raises the bar and goes a bit quicker again.
Nobody knows how fast John can go. Nobody has actually taken John to that next level.
Yeah, you never underestimate anyone. Someone could come out from the woodwork that you just didn't really expect and, you know, shock you.
I don't know much about Hutchinson, to be truthful. He's one of the quiet men in the sport. Just does the job, I think.
It reminds me a bit of myself, you know. 10 years ago, he's absorbing everything, understanding what it takes to win a big race now. The guy, you know, I think every man and his dog in the world wants fucking Guy Mike to win. And there's not a question he's going to win one. He's definitely got the talent, but there's some ingredient missing at the moment, and it just seems to find him. He's going to be the best man that's going to win on the day, at the end of the day. And nobody wants to win it more than I do.
As speeds increase, so do the dangers. And it was this that lost the TT its world championship status. But winning at the TT requires more than just speed. It relies on mechanical perfection, supreme mental and physical endurance, a huge dose of good fortune, and a very fast pit stop. A tank of fuel and a set of tires will only last 2 of the 4 or 6 laps required. Pit stops count toward the overall lap time and can make or break a rider's chances.
33.
Yeah. Sorry. I think we have one mistake, close to 40.
I'm swinging out in the binary to do a fast pit stop. Just happened, the bike I had last year was sold to a bloke on the Isle of Man. And I begged and pleaded with him to see if we can borrow the swinging arm back out of his bike to put back in my new bike for this year. So he says, pop up and nick it this afternoon and then we'll go tomorrow morning and put it back in the bike.
We could do it your help.
Guy's father has decided not to come to the race this year.
Bit of an ad. Feels a tet, really, my dad not coming. You know, he's a good man to have involved because he's got so much experience around here. He's rode the TT for 15 years and he knows exactly how things need to be. That'd give me confidence if he was involved. And now he's not here. It's not fuck the job, but it's made it a lot harder. And it took my eye off the ball a little bit. But what do I do? I can sit and cry about it, can't I? Mike Finnegan, really good friend of mine in racing. I was at his wedding in, I think it had been a November time of 2007. Yeah, 2007. And then his funeral was in April time of 2008. You know, teammate of mine, Darren Lindsay, was killed in 2005. A friend of mine used to do his engines, Richard Brittany, was killed in 2006. You could go on.
I just think, you know, your time's up. You know, and I think you've got to be in this line of work. You know, and that's why I sort of don't believe in having any commitments of any sort. Because if I did have responsibilities as wife, kids, mortgage and all that sort of care, but I couldn't give this job, you know, as in racing the TT, I couldn't give it me all. And I want to give it me all. Yeah, before I can start thinking about winning races, we've got a lot of practice to get through. You know, we've 5 nights of practice to get through. That's not going to be easy. It's a lot of work to do on the bike. And that's where my dad was going to come in. It's not just going to go straight in the bike. A lot of things I'll need making to get that swinging arm to suit the new bike. But if it was easy,
Every man and his dog would be at it, wouldn't they?
Chill out later on. Just like I find a different place every night to keep in my van. Just get me airbed blown up in the back of my van. Bit of a wank and go to sleep, you know. Proper. There's no, you know, people get all, it's not a crime, is it? To have a wank, you know. Okay.
You never get complacent with the TT, you know, there's always something you can learn and, you know, if you get that way and overconfident, it'll bite you. I just went up and had a little moment on my own looking down the road because the road was shut. Wasn't a sound apart from the birds just tweeting away. And that's just something real special about the track itself, you know, I was just looking down thinking, you know, next week I'm going to... the race, I'm going to be going down there at 200 mile an hour plus, you know.
The emotion you feel when you roll up onto that start line and you're getting waved off 10 seconds apart, it's just unbelievable, you know. It's like nothing else I've ever experienced.
It's not about beating the next guy, it's about who beats the track.
This TT is the most powerful race you'll ever do in your life. I love it, like, it's legal.
People often ask, you know, why do you road race? Because circuit racing is fast, you can get a buzz, but it's not the same. Circuit racing is rock climbing with a rope. It's dangerous, but there is some room for error. You slip, you fall, you got a rope. Road racing is like free climbing. You know, you climb up that same mountain, you're on a course, but there's no room for error. If you make a mistake, it's going to be... you know, well, could be serious injury or worse.
You're doing maybe 170, 180 miles an hour, going through fast bends with trees, hedges, brick walls. It's the greatest thing.
And you realise the dangers before you put the leg over the bike. I mean, the top of Bray Hill before I go out, you know, you have lots of strange thoughts in your mind and you're nervous and you're worried. But as soon as you set off and you get the tap off the start marker to go down Bray Hill, that's gone. And once you're actually out here, the noise, the wind, the physical strain on your body, there's nothing like it. It's just, you put yourself through hell and you frighten yourself so many times. That is the draw.
Up there, you can't fake it, you know. There's nothing that you can do that isn't put you in the moment, and this is it. This, you know, especially if you ride two wheels, you know, this is about as difficult as it gets. I mean, people talk about extreme sports. There's nothing more extreme than road racing. One split second. You know, somebody like Joey Dunlop, 31 years of career, 26 TT wins, all those other race wins, all those world championships, one split second.
There is no room for error on the TT course. Of all road racing circuits, it is the toughest and most unforgiving. With an average 5 deaths for every mile, only a lucky few have crashed and escaped unharmed. Milky Quail is one of the lucky ones.
Your life revolves around the TT because it's such an immense, passionate thing. Whether you're on the track or off the track, it is a life and death thing. I know it sounds crazy and stuff. I mean, I haven't raced around here now for, what, 8-9 years? And I still now struggle with life because I can't do it, you know, I can't get any buzz. It's like, you've done the ultimate
and once you can't have that ultimate, then you're a bit like a, you know, a drug addict sort of thing. You just can't, you can't get out of your system. You love it. When I'm sat beside the track, you just want to do it. You know, it gives you, you think, yeah. And then, so obviously, if you keep yourself busy, and whether it's blooming, sweeping the floors, or emptying the bins, or, you know, taking all the riders round, or, you know, meeting dignitaries and taking press round, it, it keeps my mind off it, really.
Milky looks after the newcomers and shows them around the course. It can take 3 years of competing to learn it, and at least that long to build up the confidence needed to push themselves to the limits.
It's all about confidence. You need to be confident where the corners go and how fast you can go around that corner to build up your speed. So I'm still experimenting on how fast I can go, a little bit more. As I build up and get used to the corners and the bumps and the rises and tipping points and the grids and everything, hopefully, yeah, I'll keep going a bit faster.
Get over! Oh, in by the hedge, transfer back over the bike again. Oh, into here, and guess what? There's another one here. Oh, that takes you 3 years to get right.
After only 2 years of competing, Jenny Tinmouth is the fastest woman ever around the course.
You definitely feel like you shouldn't be doing it. It's quite bizarre. You do feel cheeky and a bit naughty, you know, to be blasting around the roads. But I think that, again, that's half the fun. And like when you set off down Bray Hill, it's just massive big grin. It's like, just...
I don't come up here. All I'm thinking about is the next corner that's coming up, which is called Balagueri. It's affectionately known as Balascary because it is. It's so, so scary. It's so fast, it's the most important, but also the most dangerous corner on the circuit. The big problem with Balagueri is it's on site on your entry point. So as I'm coming up to here now, I'm still hard on the gas, At the 30-mile-an-hour signs here now, this is where I come off the gas. I come down one gear, effectively. I get my head out of the bubble, and my head's getting ripped off my shoulders. But at that point, also, I'm trying to look to, for my PLM point, but I still can't see it. I know it goes to the right, but where do I turn in? As soon as I see the curb on the inside, I lay the bike on its side and drive it, OK? And just fire through right by the curb. So, so fast.
Averaging 131.57 miles per hour, John McGuinness is still the fastest man around the course. 100 years ago, the first race was won at just 38 miles per hour. Throughout its history, even riders with no hope of winning have come to break personal bests and challenge the island's famous course. Riders are always chasing faster and faster lap times.
First place, this is Nick
Crowe,
he's still
second. I just think it's got a certain addiction about it. Once you get here, you couldn't let it go, then, you know, you're looking at the ultimate lap times all the time. And, I always set out beating myself more than anybody else, you know. Every year, I just thought I'd do faster and faster and faster, which I was actually doing, unfortunately, until the time of my accident, which was really a fault of my own. It's just one of them freak things, you know.
In 2009, while leading the race, a hare ran onto the track, causing Nick to crash his sidecar at 160 miles per hour.
I think it just caught, damaged his front part of the fairing, and caught and hit me in the face, and that was it. And I had, obviously, the bike turned immediately right then, and that was it, and straight into the trees. And yeah, we were lucky to get away with that one.
If we have an injury or a fatality, I tend to sort of want to stop. Because, yeah, I do. I feel like a drug dealer sometimes because I'm preparing these engines for these people to go and hurt themselves with. And even though it's, you know, touch wood, not my fault, you know, the people who deal in drugs are worse than the people who take them. And so last year we had such a terrible time. I did so that I wouldn't carry on with the sidecars. And then the way Nick bounced back was just, I couldn't say no to him at all, you know, so we've got three engines already for him, we're doing two more. His spirit's unbelievable.
Nick himself won't be riding. Instead, his own race team will attempt to break the sidecar lap record, which has stood unbroken since his accident.
It's a fine guy.
Yeah. No problem with his license. Have you got a problem with your license, Gary?
Typically, Guy is nowhere to be found, and he won't be eligible to practice without his race license. Until he returns, the bike can't go through scrutineering.
We don't know where he is, as usual. He'll be here in a minute.
Guy Martin, where do you start?
He is a maverick. He's an eccentric.
He's always got something good to say, although a lot of the time it comes out it's not broadcastable.
He's a bit old school. He's a bit what we grew up with, what we used to be.
Guy's a fabulous personality. I don't think Guy really knows exactly what he wants to do. He's got a lot of different loves in his life.
I'd like to see him win around here, but if you're not careful, we run out of time.
Guy's colourful character. It's an attention seeker in treating, though. He loves a bit of attention. He's had great shorts on for 2 years. I mean, they must be stinking and grown legs by now. But that's what racing's all about. We need characters in there, you know. Guy is what he is. I mean, he talks pure rubbish, but he's funny.
Guy says it as it is. I think that's why he's so popular with people. He's not worried about upsetting the hierarchy. Guy Martin's Guy Martin, and nobody would want him any other way. I mean, he is a true grit, and he's a John Wayne of motorcycle racing.
At last, Guy returns after blowing up a friend's classic bike in the south of the island.
There you are.
It's
all
sorted
now.
Spot on. Thank you
very
much. Cheers, man.
The road should be closing in half an hour, and tonight's practice will start at 7:30.
Guy's race license approved. The team can finally make it through scrutineering with the bikes.
The horses are
going to
the
target is now 7:25. The road will be closing in tonight. This will
be here in 5 minutes. 5 minutes, ladies and gentlemen. 5 minutes. Number 8, Guy Martin, number 19, James Kennedy, and Luke DeMarco, with the mics as well.
Off of my eyes, we're on stalks, you know, you see the whites in my eyes all the time. You come to TT and your body's unfamiliar to start with.
Stuff's just going past so fast. Starting start lap 125 mile an hour, you know, first lap, and it's like, I must be mad.
It's spectacular, and when you've just, you know, plodded along on your road by thinking you were a legend riding fast. You know, it's like a totally different thing when you see the race bikes come through.
You know, you might have driven to the pits that morning, so your top speed for the day so far is maybe 40 miles an hour. You let the clutch out, and within a couple of miles, you're pushing 200 miles an hour between, you know, stone walls and hedges, so it takes a bit to get your head up to speed.
But then you settle down, start relaxing and getting more and more comfortable with the circuit. You start going faster, you start becoming smoother, you start breathing properly.
You do go into like this weird sort of state of mind where everything starts slowing down.
you start moving, your eye line starts lifting so much and your brain starts working so much and ahead of yourself.
You're thinking like maybe four or five corners ahead. It's all about momentum and keeping your rhythm up and not getting into any stupid battles with people, you know. You got to be really using your head.
I'm a real hard rider, right? But if you want to race off me, you know what I mean? You're going to have to move out to wrap around a post, you know what I mean? And that's the way I race motorbikes, and that's the way I push, and I'll push any man to the better end. If they want to play ball, you know, they can play with me, you know?
Six gear, never close throttle, and this is it's also for me, you know, I ride the bike for many years, say wow, really wow.
Even after all these years, to talk to somebody about the Isle of Man TT course, the hair stands up on the back of your neck and you remember, and I'll never ever forget my first flying lap at the TT, going over St. Ninian's Crossroads down Bray Hill, and I thought I'd come off the end of the world. Really, I thought I'd ridden off the end of a cliff. You know, you just feel you could fly, really. And most of the times you do.
Everybody wants to know.
Because on his return, he has illegally ridden it through the town.
No, I've got a working skeleton.
What, for riding through the holding area there, or riding through the town?
Riding through the town, probably.
You're supposed to read that bit before you go out. But I didn't see you as you were playing with the
grid. Oh, that's telling you
how to do what you did. Really, really, Mr. Craig, this is where you come in.
I'm going to blame you, Charlie.
Blaming you, yeah.
Oh, fucking
Mega.
Where's Rob?
He's got his...
He's perfect.
No problem.
Oh, yeah. More badges.
Yeah, every year.
Good man.
Guy will get his bike back. Once he apologizes.
Who do I go see tomorrow, Valakin? Can I take my bike?
You're on a jet?
I won't mind.
I know you're on a diet.
Okay.
Help yourself. Go on, get in there.
I don't like you, mate.
Thanks, lads.
Thank you. Alright, Bob.
Jump building, blind boy. Okay, we are pushing on the front of that shell.
When I want to begin.
I know all the dirt right dirty tricks. I'm a mouse when I'm out in winter. In a 50-mile race, I am the best. I ride 5 miles and skip the rest. So come along and see me riding in the TT races. Down the hill I go at breakneck speed. See me coming down the street with the winning post on the pavilion seat. Oh, come along and see me riding in the TT race.
Absolutely 2 weeks of my life. Yeah. It's just something that that to me is like the World Cup. It's just 50 years of my life is 100 weeks. It's, you know, it's just unbelievable. The atmosphere that friends have made from all around the world. See every year, lose some, gain some. It's just something special.
People say to me, oh, you've got children, you know, you shouldn't be allowing him to do it. But you took racing away from Dan and it would just be the end of Dan's wheels, and I can't do that to him, you know. He's my husband, I love him, so I have to support him.
You're up in the grandstand sitting together, you know, with the rest of the families and the rest of the wives, you know, you were all nervous, but you kind of have to sort of have a little joke and a laugh. It's amazing the strength that comes from within, really, with all of everybody together, you all sort of club together and get yourself through it, really.
The road race is great, the fence is always the same thing. Every single one of them is the same thing. It'll never happen to me. But somewhere in there, they know very well that it can happen to them. And between those two places, there's a lot of ways of dealing with it.
I wore the same crash helmet for the last 11 years and, you know, I always wear a certain pair of socks throughout the whole fortnight, and I always drop a penny down my leathers as well before the start of every race, yeah. Makes no difference whatsoever, but I wear pink knickers if it was going to make me win.
That's what you need.
I'll stick it back over the fence in a minute. Cheers, mate. I'll pass the fence. Cheers, mate.
I'll stick it down there, boy.
There's no question that the Isle of Man TT represents kind of the last bastion of the freedom of choice. And to come to a place like this and to have something so truly, you know, potentially dangerous be welcomed, really, is refreshing. It's charming. It's all of the things that should be allowed to go on other places. I mean, for human beings, life isn't a dress rehearsal. You only get one lap. Why not make it a good one?
This is where I start the mountain climb. So this one I have to slow down for. Back down second gear. Boom! I get into that wall, into there. As I come through here, the bump just there. Bang! So we run now, up through this little right-hand cake here. Still flat. On the power. Underneath the wall. Off the power, down one gear. Boom! Back on the power now to drive. Under, drive. Back down the second gear. Pull up on it straight, get up, get the driving on, up towards these little left-hand kings here. So with this first one here, just get back underneath that, out towards the tree on the right-hand side of the road, right to here, okay? Three marks and out towards Guthrie's, okay? Guthrie's is the third most important corner on the circuit. Got three left-hand bends here, okay? It's very steep. This is the one, get the first one right,
Get into that one, into there, out to the right line, back into number two, out to number three, just there. See the corner on the brakes hard. Down 3 gears. 1, 2, 3. Back into there, back on the power, drive it through. Right towards the white line, back over towards the external white line, back in there underneath this one just here, feather in the throttle, there we go, lovely, nice wheelie, bang.
Over the next 7 days, there will be many scrapes and near misses, 7 cracked vertebrae, 4 broken ribs, 5 life-threatening incidents, 2 bruised lungs, and unfortunately, much worse.
Which camera? In there.
It's a plan.
What?
Tea.
Yeah, yeah, it's tea. And get early start in the morning. Boys know. Now the plan, Wilson. What's the plan? These boys are asking what the plan is.
The plan is you're raiding the bank.
Well,
there you go, that's
it. No, it's gentle. Well, obviously it's better for the mist up here in Douglas at the moment around the area here, but it is clear up on the top.
Starting off with the TT Superbike race, 6 laps of the mountain course, 2 miles. A reminder, this is a time trial. They go as 10 seconds interval, so they're racing the clock just as much as each other. Most of all, of course, they race well. They race tradition. They race the history of the mountain course. We're 1 minute away from the start of racing at this year's TT.
The laws of average tell me he's going to win. I would like him to win the first race, because I believe that will settle him if he wins the first race that won 3 or 4. I really believe that.
And it is a Suzuki that's second scoring. There goes Bruce Amstey, with Mist still rolling along that country road, but we are racing. And there goes the number one machine of Bruce Amstey, very compact there through Union Mills. And there is John McGuinness, the fastest man in the history of the mountain course. And here's Hutchie with 2 weeks last year. Off on a superbike. And next door finish, number 8, 28 years of age. Here comes Guy now. He's fast down Bray Hill.
It's Anthony. And here we go. We're on. 2 together. John McGuinness leads on the road. Ahead of Bruce Anthony.
Cameron Donald closing the gap between him and Peter Moore. They've got a battle on there. The advantage being held by Cameron Donald. But here's Guy Martin now, and he's quick.
John McGuinness has had an amazing start to this race, but Connor Cummins, the local lad, is right behind him, only 0.08 of a second down in second place.
I'm here in the grandstand, I can tell you from my speed that Connor Cummins has taken the lead and put up on corrected time, a 3 second lead over John McGuinness. But John
clearly has problems because at the Selby speed trap he's gone through at only 136.4 miles an hour.
So clearly problems with John McGuinness and the big Honda. Off to Ramsey and Roy Moore.
Well, they said it was going to be close, it certainly is, because Guy Martin, oh my goodness, Guy Martin was nearly taken out there by Michael Dunlop, but it was close.
Connor Cummins, number 10, lead by 6 seconds. Rory and Hutchinson, with 10 in third place. Guy Martin, just 1 second down on Hutchinson. John McGuinness is in retirement on Sulby Street. What a disappointment. King of the Mountain is out on the first lap, but on with the show. Number 10 has increased his lead to 15 seconds over number 4, Ian Hutchinson.
You can see Mansfield on the top of the podium, first time for several years. Cummins has got a fantastic lead now, 21 seconds. If he can just hang it together, there'll certainly be some Guinness drunk in the Swan in Ramsey tonight.
And Ian Hutchinson's lap time, 130.496. So here's Connor now, let's have a look at this. Oh, it's 131.511 by Connor Cummins. And wow, what a performance by the man from Ramsey.
Well,
Well, the light came on at Cromley Mona to signal the arrival of number 6, Cameron Donald, but he's failed to appear. Now, we reckon that Cameron may have made a mistake on that lap, so possibly an overshoot at signpost. That seems one logical explanation for that.
Yeah, we've just got another machine coming in now. The big guy Martin is in now, guys, just coming in to the top of the pit lane now. There's Connor's on the way, he's just been told there. Bring it home, Connor, bring it home. He knows he's got a 21.1 at Glen Helen on this lap, 23.3. Well, that's the klaxon going. Hutchie leaves now, and Cameron, he'll be kicking himself for that mistake. He's now dropped to 13. Oh, Connor stalls, Connor stalls! Is he going to get it going here now? It's just one final.
Guy, fast into the speed limiter there, and nails it, Charlie Lambert. So a 21-second lead, and all of a sudden it was down to 4 seconds. 17 seconds disappeared during the course of that problem of getting the big ZX-10 fired up again. So it's all to play for them in the final 2 laps, and there's some work to be done by Cameron to eat into Connor's lead. So, Colin Cummings, Ian Hutchinson, Guy Martin and Michael Dunlop, those are the top four. The order is the same, but the gap has most certainly changed. There's the lead late number runners now in pit lane. And here's number 26, Paul Dobbs, racing with the Kiwi on his helmet. And there's Jenny away now. And we've just had news that Colin's missing.
Colin Cummings missing here at Glen Helen. Out here, so the machine comes into view now. No, it's not Connor either. That's number 8, Guy Martin. Connor missing at Glen Helen.
Tell you what's happened to Connor. He's a retirement, mechanical failure at Laurel Bank. A retirement at Laurel Bank, mechanical failure. Huge disappointment there for Connor. So it's Ian Hutchinson, number 4, who's leading on the road. He's number 8, Guy Martin, into second place for now. And there's 1, 2, 3 into view now. Those three are going to have a real scramble. That's going to be well worth looking at. Not only Connor that has bad news, we've just heard that the new timing system here in the pits has claimed its first high-profile victim, with Guy Martin picking up a 30-second time penalty. That's moved him down from what would have been second place down to fourth place. So off the podium for Guy, and Ian Hutchinson, the 12-year-old from Bingley in Yorkshire, is the leader of the Superbike TT, with Michael Dunlop now in second place. I know it's actually winning, but keep an eye on number 6, Cameron Donald, despite that excursion at signpost, finishing the race very strongly indeed, and that final place on the podium is not nailed just yet. See the checkered flag, it is now being prepared. Here comes the wheelie of Ian Hutchinson, and Ian Hutchinson wins on the Magic Honda. Final result, she won, she won. Dunlop 2, Dunlop
3,
Guy Martin finishing in
4th
place, and it was a
bad
penalty that cost Guy so dearly.
So when I was in pit lane, I heard him announce that Guy had gone through speed lane too fast, and there was a time penalty against him. Now that's all I've heard.
Thank
you. Gary was told he just jumped off the bike, got into his van, he didn't even take his helmet off. I'm sure he'll come back again. It's a big disappointment, the guy. You know, he's just done 224 miles at those speeds, and then I'm told we're penalising you for nothing. Such a tiny thing, 0.1 over 60. There shouldn't be a 30-second penalty. 5, possibly. That's harsh.
They're measuring your average speed over a distance. Now, who's to say that their distance that they're measuring over is accurate? It's within a millimetre.
We're booked for the regulations, by the way. And unfortunately, I perhaps also ought to say that in the matter of timekeeping, the timekeeper, his word is law, and he records what are then considered to be matters of fact from which there is no protest or appeal. Okay.
Yeah, well, that's it. Monday's a new day, isn't it? And, you know, Guy's got another two races on Monday, so, you know, as long as Guy turns up this evening open-minded and puts today's race behind him, you know, he's got another superbike race as well on Friday. We'll just move on from it. Action on the mountain course, two races, 600cc machines on first at 10:45.
Nothing has flicked them from the start.
The last guy, Martin, is still leading the race by just over a second from Ian Hutchinson, with Dan Mead in third place.
Guy Martin is here at Ramsey Hairpin lap one, and he still leads, and he looks determined today.
News from the top of the mountain from the bungalow is that Ian Hutchinson has halved the gap on Guy Martin, and it is Ian Hutchinson who leads at the end of the first lap.
Guy Martin obviously likes that stretch of course between the grandstand and here, because he's consistently quicker, but Hutchinson seems to get in on him everywhere else.
He's chosen a bullseye shape here. Guy Martin is leading the race. Now Ian Hutchinson has gone back into the lead.
Guy Martin back into the lead. There's Hutchie now leading on the road.
Charlie, what's the difference as Guy comes in?
3.3 seconds, so Hutchie has been going away a little bit.
Guy Martin's been told you can do this. I'm sure there's thousands of you out there would like him to do this. The guy who pulled himself there on the way, we heard a lot of shouting.
Guy goes through with Keith Abbott off on his tail.
Michael Dunlop slots into third,
but it is Ian Hutchinson who's extended the lead. It's now over 4 seconds. Stand by a bench, because the news from the lap is that Guy Martin has halved the gap. Ian Hutchinson is coming towards the end of the race, but Guy Martin has now put it down for less than 3 seconds at the clock. Guy Martin is having the laugh of his life, but is it going to be enough to give him his first victory here at the TT? Hutchie crosses the line right now, but where is Guy? He started 40 seconds after Hutchie.
He started the stopwatch, and we're going to be counting it all the way down to those 40 seconds. 37, 38, it's 39. It is victory for Ian Hutchinson by 3.03. Guy Martin is in second place. Michael Dunlop is in third place, with a final lap of 126.587.
The 1-2-3 is Hutchinson, Martin and Michael Dunlop, and it's down to this day.
I don't know where
Tim, where's your guy gone to, actually?
I can tell you he went straight up the return, and as much as we know at the moment, so going...
Did not come into the winner's enclosure. He went straight up the return, I'll have to find out what's going on there.
Okay, Charlie, can you see?
There's people in the paved room, but it's nothing to do with us. Paul's trying to do it, you know what I mean? It's not Paul, Paul doesn't make the rules.
Yeah, this is me being...
No, we're not really proud of you, it's just... Please.
Come on,
guys.
Get yourself down there, Guy.
Wouldn't you be pleased?
Yeah, Guy, I'd be upset, but I wouldn't take out on the people that spoke to me.
0.112.
Whoa, Guy, brakes.
I'm going to hold his bum in a minute. Now then, boss.
All right,
where'd you go?
60.112. That's you I've been picking. Is he me being picky? I'll do what I want at my speed.
So this is Saturday's race you're on about, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'll let you get down the bottom there and we'll have a longer chat later on. Okay, Guy, thank you very much. Guy's off there now.
That was a bit of a Guy Martin protest we saw there. You going straight in. If I walked at 0.112 over a kilometre an hour, do you know how far I'd go? 0.112 over a kilometre, how far is that? This here.
Okay.
which he deserved as well. It's been a terrific morning's racing, and these guys will remember this for one reason or another for a very long time. And Guy Martin is not hanging around at the top of the podium. He's already making his way down. He's taking his bottle of bubbly with him, though.
They've been awkward of me, I'll be awkward of them. I'll just do things. And when you, oh, you've got to do this, you've got to do that, you know, press this, press that, fuck it off. They've been awkward of me, I'll be fucking awkward of them. That's simple. No problem. No problem. Don't worry, that's only the tip of the iceberg. You'll wait till I win a fuck. I don't even think about it really, man. Just agree with them. You're best off. Out, I say, was just out grapes. Anything at all, I say, I could have said out. So, I had to do an interview yesterday morning. Yeah, I just said, oh, I was happy to finish fourth. Happy. That's where I wanted to be. Obviously, not, I wanted to win it, didn't I? Well, I'm not helping you with dickheads like that, are they? Oh, well. Worst things happen at sea. We're still here, aren't we? Yeah, we're going around it well. Obviously not well enough. Oops, you beat me. Yeah, I know what needs to be done. There's another three races left yet, isn't there? It'll come.
And there is the race leader, Ryan Farquhar. Really looking down to it. Something must have gone wrong at the start. The guy, he was well outside the top 10. It's Hutchie's victory by 1.3 seconds. Hutchie, Ryan and Connor in that order. It's Maximum Hutchie winning 3 TTs in a week, and there are still 2 solo TTs to go.
I just gave it absolutely everything I could, and just unbelievable, man. Unbelievable.
I just sat watching some onboards while I'm getting a plan of attack, so if Jeffrey is from 2002, and then bits of Uchi. I'm going through the tyre sections too hot, and then I'm losing the run on the long sprays.
Good morning, Paul.
How you doing?
What about today's conditions? When you sat when you woke up this morning, you must have thought, oh no.
Oh, teammates are late this year and he assures me that it's going to come right, so...
Alright Paul, I'll let you get together and get warm, he looks freezing.
You're looking as if you're not ready for a race either.
Nah, well yeah, I mean, yeah, it's not safe, is it? No, he can't go racing, then I'm racing.
Michael Dunlop is
is coasting, Michael Dunlop crosses the line, but it is Ian Hutchinson who has won the race, and not just that, he has made the most amazing piece of history here today. First man in history to win the first four TT races, and only the second man after Philip McCallum to win four in a week. Ian Hutchinson, the new king of the mountain, no question about it.
Well, we're on the start line, and then shake hands with your mates and always wish them all the best. I set off behind my mate Paul Dobbs, because you're 10 seconds apart. You can count them when they just disappear. You start counting.
You can hear them coming down from the campsite, down in the dip, and then back up. You can hear them speed coming out there, and you can tell the men from the voice. Because they gear down, they drop a cog down, and then they ease off slightly, then they open it up and rip it around the corner. But I have to say, the top boys, they just don't bother, they just keep it going flat. He just came around the corner so well, clipped it, the bike went. The height of the bus stop, it just went straight up, and the height of the bus stop, that's down there. It's like a battle round.
I was just closing on him, and then we come up to Balagueri, and I just seen him go off into the corner, and then the yellow flags come out, so I knew there'd been an incident. I've blown the engine or crashed, so I could hear the other riders coming, so I just grabbed the flag and just run into the track to slow the other riders down. The medics tried everything they could for him. But yeah, he'd have been cheesed off if he'd have been in the car and got squashed by a tractor or something like we're here, we race, we know the dangers. It's not tiddlywinks or whatever. Well, yeah, that's why everybody gets on, if you can help each other. But sadly, he'd lost his life to the sport that he loves, like so. Just one of them, mate.
I had one of those moments, you know, that happened at some point. Once or twice during every TT fortnight, and I just stand and look around, and everything you see, the bikes, the overalls, you know, you hear that siren, pit entry siren, or everything going on, I just thought, I love this. And I actually thought, stupid moment of clarity, God, I'd miss this if I couldn't have it, because something happens to Dobsy. An hour later. Anyone could lose their partner tomorrow. People step out under a bus. People are lost every day. You talk about that and joke about it all the time, you know. I might not be here next week, is what people say. But when it is part of your consciousness, even a subconscious part, it really does make you love life. Makes you appreciate who you've got and what's special about them and just how lucky you are. The reason we make that choice to go racing is just the whole, you know,
we're here for a good time. What can, you know, how can we get the most fun out of life? And we want the kids to share that as well. They come along, they love it, they're part of it. Because we had that time with them, it's made us who we are, it's made them who they are. You know, they're incredible. They're strong, they're fun. And we have fun, you know, we have so much fun. It doesn't stop. And we're gonna keep on having fun, you know. Ride the bikes, play the music, dance in the kitchen, you know. Still love the TT, still love the island, you can't change that. You can't love the death, you can't love the loss, but you can't love the excitement and the thrill without knowing that that's part of it. It wouldn't be so exciting if it didn't have the risk. That's why they want to do it.
This is Friday, senior day. This is the day we've all been waiting for. It's the final, and it's the race of the year as far as we're concerned. Big prize, people call it the power and the glory. It just means so much. So we will be putting a big effort into this, a huge effort. Everyone's ready, and Guy is up for it. So, he's just arrived. That's him on the dirty old bicycle, the push bike.
Will it be an unbelievable five at Ian Hutchinson? Can John McGuinness?
At a second, at a fourth, yesterday, at a fifth in the set. So I've not had the best weeks really, just a few little issues. In the way of just by itself, but it's all focus and thought, and I've got to try and tech them through into today's race and go play the part, see what I can do. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to try my hardest, but then sometimes I've been watching on boards, I've been watching this and watching that, and am I trying too hard? And I think I look in a couple of places and I am, and that's what's holding me back. So yeah, I'll put my finger out. That penalty, I didn't feel really hard but done by it. Worst things happen at sea. I just come sat in here with my helmet and my boots, my gloves, my leathers and all that shit on. I just sat here and... At the time, if someone were coming here, if Mr. Speed Gun Man or whatever were coming here, I'd thrash fuck out of him. But, really... Mr. Speed Gun Man, I'd thrash fuck out of him. I'm not a fighting man, but there's a time and a place for everything. And someone's like that going on. Point, whatever, I don't even get me started on it.
1-4 so far, and it'd be great to get the fifth, and you know, it'd be the fairy tale story. But obviously, everyone's been gunning out to get me all week, and I think in some respects, the pressure's kind of off them with it just being one person that's done it all week. What more can I do? It's not as if, you know, there's been four different winners and they haven't won one. It's just, I think maybe the pressure's off them a little bit, but on the other side of it, it's the last race this year, and you know, if they really are determined to win a TT this year, this is the last chance.
If you go out there with your head riled, you know, if I listen to Rage Against the Machine before I go out, you're going out there with the wrong frame of mind. So I'm going to go out there and listen to... I think I might have a bit of Otis Redding on before I go out. Yeah. Smoke me 10 Bensons. Do you want 10 Bensons?
That'll do,
won't it? Yeah, I'm taking up smoking after July. But there's been a few moments in this past couple of weeks where I've just thought... But I've not smoked, so I think a bit about Otis Redding on the start line. Pretend to smoke a fag and take it as it comes.
Oh,
conclusion here.
We're going to have the senior TT race going
in just under an hour's time at 12:30, and we will of course give you all the build-up and the interviews as the riders get out.
Number one machine of Bruce Anstey. The lap record still standing at 31.578 miles an hour. That's set by John McGuinness last year. Less than 10 seconds to go.
And I can tell the members of the Guy Martin fan club over there on the far side of Glen Country Road that their man is still one of the favourites, along with the big local home number 10, Connor Cummins. The last 2 seconds tick away. We watch the flag which drops. We are now ready. Bruce Anstey, Mountain Maestro, John McGuinness, now number 3. Ian Rocker.
That's Hutchie on the number 4.
DJ Morgan
and Cameron Donald.
So Michael's away on the Honda. Guy Martin on the Wilson Craig Honda. Guys off the racing.
And he's absolutely on song today. It's all about those guys on the 8 and 10 plates, Guy Martin and Connor Cummins, but it's so close right behind them. Hutchie and John McGuinness are right there in the mix.
Gone into the lead. Snatched the lead from Guy Martin, but there's 0.58 seconds in it.
In front of me here now, red torpedo on the back of his leathers. Just watch that speed, go on.
Guy Martin, let me just give you his details. 130.642, and he was the race leader at Crockett Moto, but still waiting for Connor. Connor's here now, 130.278.
A brand new tyre in for Guy. He fires up and he is away right now. So great pit stop by the Wilson Craig team, and it's the McAdoo boys who are on it now. Tyne her up, Martha Mocter says go, 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 go. She fires and the big man is away now.
between Hutchinson and Michael Dunlop and Keith Moore appearing here, and the road goes quiet here for a moment or two, but we're still waiting machine number 8. So we don't appear to have a Guy Martin here. Guy Martin is missing.
Well, back here on the grandstand, we're not sure if we've got a red flag situation. The race has been stopped because a fire engine has to go onto the track. It's clearly something very serious at Balaguerre. It's only the second season race in 100 years to be red flagged.
Incident at Balaguerre. And, Guy Martin has a great spot at the point of Glen Ellen.
Red flag, boys! Red flag!
We believe it's Guy Martin. He's crashed and the bike set fire to a field, and that's one of the only times they'll put red flags out.
Gut wrenching for everyone. The team are pacing up and down. You can see the team boss's head down, not knowing what's going on. I mean, nobody knows any better than anybody.
First we knew about it was when Guy didn't arrive at Glen Holland. We like to think that it's a mechanical failure rather than a crash. Then we heard the hedge was on fire at Glen Vine.
Only riders and officials are allowed in the park throwing area. Everybody else out, please. Thank you.
You could see the fire in the distance about a mile away. There was smoke, and then one of the hay bales was on fire, and they slowed us way down. And then I thought, okay, well, there's the hay bale on fire, and then, well, there's the bike in somebody's yard. And I'm like, okay, we're past the incident. A quarter mile later, there was Guy. And it was like, shit.
There was an incident. Guy was missing, so it had to be him. He crashed at something like 170 miles an hour, so he was off at that speed. And of course you worry, you know, you don't jump from a bike at 170 miles an hour and get up again. So, yes, we were worried.
Well, Dobbs crashed there last night, and, you know, he didn't make it. So, fingers crossed for Guy. It's hit and miss there, you know. There's no run out as there isn't anywhere on the circuit here, and Guy seems to have made a little bit of a rider error sort of thing, and he's gone into the wall. It's not looking good. I came up on the circuit, you know, it just looks like a bomb's exploded when out goes on here. The wall and all the bales were on fire, you know. Guy's laid there in the track, his bike's split in pieces, like it's, you know, it's horrendous. Yeah, everyone's fingers crossed at the minute to see how Guy is. It's just how it is, sort of thing. We all enter it, there's no fun to our heads to enter. We all love it, and at the end of the day, if it goes wrong and the worst does happen, you've died a happy man, like. You know, the show's going on, we've got 4 laps coming here, we're at 3 o'clock start. No, it'll be no slower.
Now let's give you the track conditions. Road, lack of addition at Balaguerre, dry around the rest of the course. Visibility good for that race.
Got me fingers crossed for Connor today. He'll be out there giving it the berries as usual. I'm right behind you, Connor, if you're listening.
Four laps, 150.92 miles. John McGinnis, the race leader in the race before it was abandoned, is away on number two. This is Ian Hutchinson. Number 10, Connor Cummins, looking so good for the first couple of laps. He's got to keep it together for the full race of the day. And here comes the first of those machines, it is McGinnis. Here's Hutchie now, 0.61, that's all there is between the two of them. And sad to report, Michael is a retirement at Joey's, and Cameron is off the bike. Here's Connor now, head down.
Now the big news here at Glen Hill in lap 2. McGuinness appears to be out.
At the 3.24 seconds that Ian Hutchinson leads number 10, Connor Cummins.
The sound and the blur, but the blur stopped. He's coming around the corner, good race line, really good race line in all fairness to him. And he was flying around. Bike comes down and kicks the bike away, and the bike literally turns into a fireball on impact. It's like the start of a TV program, like an all-action TV program, where the screen is filled with flames. And this silhouette comes towards us out of a waist height, and it's Guy. And I'm thinking, oh, here we go, I've got a job. Yeah, the first thing that springs to my mind, like. So I reached around, grabbed my orange box, the med box. I turn around there, and Guy's flying past me, followed by a bike which is on fire, and it just screams past me. And then the bike goes over to one side, and it's still in flames. I mean, it's black smoke everywhere, it's flames, a heck of a mess on there. And Guy's in the middle. I told him, I'm not going to cut your leathers, because you know, I need to check you over first of all. And he said, you know, don't cut my leathers. Now I understand that, because I'm a biker, like, and that's the last thing I'd want is somebody to cut my leathers. But he was good. He was good. Definitely somebody's up there watching him. No doubt about it. Lucky Guy.
I thought, right,
job was looking good.
131 and a half from a standing start. Slow him to come into the pits, I think 130.6. Battling for the lead. Ran out from the pits, got about 5 mile out Glenvine. Took the front. Thought I got it. See, I've had a few moments like this. You just ride into the grip that you've got. And I was riding up to that point of, I knew whether it was decent grip. You couldn't really push past that point. Because I just left the pits, we did another full tank of petrol. And I had this idea in my head, the grip that I'd ride up to. And obviously not. I think the full tank of petrol probably made a bit of difference. Lost the front. Fat funner. You know, one of the faster corners of the track, probably 160, 70 mile an hour. Took the front and I thought, I've got it. No, I ain't got it. There's a jump ship. And I think I ended up with a few bits of singed eyebrows and eyelashes and singed me fringe and what have you. But it's, I ended up in the wall, I think, but I can't remember much, I was knocked out. Absolutely. And I'm not bad, really. I mean, it could have been a lot worse, couldn't it? Could have been a lot worse. Yeah, and I think there's nothing, it's only, you know, a bit of back off my knees and what have you. You know, sliding, you're sliding at 160, 70 miles an hour, that's a lot of heat, isn't it? No, I've got a lot of friction burns from sliding. There's a few broken ribs, punctured lung. 4 chip vertebrae and 2 crack vertebrae. apart from that, I like a new one. So yeah, just sat here and yeah, I'm sat here and I'm moving my legs about, oh, I'm invincible. Then I try and get off and I think, you know, I'm not as good as I think. Say like out with the spine, you can't rush it, can you? No, it's a stable fracture as it is at the moment, but push any harder, you know, you can, like Connor is just at the corridor there, not looking clever. You know, his back's a bit worse than mine and I'm just sending him away to get his shoulder and his elbow screwed together. But part of the game, boy. We all know the risk, no one's making us do it out. All part of the game. Put me in that position again, I'd do exactly the same again. Exactly the same again. I'll be back. He's just making me work for it, innit? So hard.
I think I've had a podium every year since 1997, so yeah, it seems weird, you know, coming up the access road and, you know, not getting a cheer and a clap and getting way past the rostrum, and I was leading the first race, it all went wrong, and then the senior, the blue ribbon race, I got up to sort of 11 second lead and the guy had the crash, and, you know, red flags come out and you've got to come back and tune yourself back in and get dialed in ready for the restart, and the restart looking like it was going good, and then we had a kill switch failure. Two pence wires snaps off the solder brakes and just puts you out of contention completely, and you know, that's a TT for you, I suppose. I mean, I've had a lot of luck in the past, I've won a lot of races around here, and when luck's not on your side, it's not happening for you, you know. For sure Guy Martin's had a worse day than I had, and for sure Connor Cummins has had a lot worse day than I have. I'm still in one piece, and you know, I'm gonna head for the ferry and get home and get my thoughts together and see what's gonna be available for next year, or you know, if nothing floats me boat, I might hang me ladders on me, you never know.
Me and the kids together have had our down times, and I haven't tried to hide anything from them. You know, we've done our crying together. And then, okay, what are we going to do now? Get over it, move on. I think the point of life is to enjoy it, have as good a time as we can while we're here and what we've got given. You can't change what you get given, but you can decide whether or not to enjoy it.
I've been to look at where the crash was. There's still bits of like green paint from either the bike or my leathers. Still on the cat's eye on the side of the road. I can actually see, you know, where it's all gone wrong. I've disappeared over the side, and the way I look at it, that's where, you know, the injury started to happen. And it's sort of, it does get you a little bit. The main one was me back. I mean, I broke that and five places and got a big scar on my back, and then as a result of getting tumbled down the hill and hitting a few things, I mean, I broke my arm in four places, some slight nerve damage to it, but that's coming back nicely. My knee was dislocated, a few scrapes, I mean, I had a fractured pelvis and fractured shoulder blade and a bruised lung as well, so there's a bit to take in, really, you know. To get my head round, it was, that was a big challenge, you know, mentally. There's no chance I'm giving up. I'm 24 year old, and I perfectly accept I've been really, really lucky, but my love for bike racing's still there, and I've got goals I want to achieve. So the first opportunity I ever get, I'll be straight on it. That's my plan, you know. Come up to the veranda next TT or whenever I get back, and just attack it like normal. It's a big one, but we'll just get on with life. The world ain't gonna stop for me.
Tremendous start! Broke the outside!
we think Ian Hutchinson, the 5 times in a week winner of the TT, may be the lad who's down there.
Unfortunately, gone to a second to last race of the year on a short circuit, not a road race, and ended up with this injury, so... I mean, it's a shame how it happened, you know, to be ridden over by somebody else. You know, when it happened and they were talking about amputating my leg, then there was only one reason I didn't want it amputated, and that's so I can race a motorbike, you know. Apart from that, nothing else really matters, so... You know, my argument was to get my foot back on, and not only get it on, I said, you know, I don't want a foot just on the end of my leg, I want a foot that's 100% working so I can get on with my job.
Something happened.
Couldn't have been a better time for it to happen, obviously 7 months until the start of the season, so I just got to get on with it and, you know, get back to fitness for the start of next year.
Take me to the light. I'm an easy lover. Take me to the fire. I'm an easy brother. I'm on fire. Put my sweet effigy. I'm a ruler. Spill my guts all the way.